Not all the teachers at college inspired me, and I had the composing stuffing taken out of me by my harmony and counterpoint teacher, so much so that it wasn't until after college that I started writing again. I can't even recall his name, but he was very young and louche, with piercing eyes, and his negativity and criticism was devastating. Most of the time, the musical energy of the people in the building had an infectious and inspiring reaction. This was the only time the opposite was true. I started college with organ as my second study, and my organ teacher, Jeffrey Hansen, very soon realised that I was not going to be the next George Thalben Ball, and we parted company at the end of the first year, though I did enjoy playing the large 1957 Walker organ at St Mark's Church, Regent's Park, where I had my lessons. I then spent a couple of terms with a charming lady called Valda Aveling and studied harpsichord before I was able to change to piano and piano accompaniment as my principal studies, with dear Anthony Lindsay teaching me both. Under his tutelage, I won the Lillian Florence Smith Prize for piano accompaniment in my final year. This was the height of the permissive society, and before the monstrous spectre of AIDS had started its evil journey. So it was at Trinity that I first met openly gay people. Some wonderful friends like ex-Trolley Dolly oboe player Mark James, composer David Crisp, and my wonderful teacher Tony Lindsay. But there were also some not-so-wonderful attempted liaisons when slightly older gay men harassed and tried to push themselves onto me. Not something I want to dwell on given my childhood experiences, but a form of abuse and, like so many, sorry to say, never reported. Staying in Kingston with the patients was the best springboard into living in London that I could have wished for, but after two terms of trekking into Bond Street each day, I was eager to move on. So I packed my trusty red trunk and moved to a flat in Camden Town.